dedicated to empowering you with information
to make positive choices
and be advocates for your overall well-being.
Welcome to The Health View.
Welcome to The Health View. I'm Yvonne Dunetz, and my guest today is Dr. Robert Posnick. Dr. Robert Posnick is a board-certified dermatologist in Nashua, New Hampshire, and is affiliated with Southern New Hampshire Medical Center. He is a graduate of Columbia College and received his medical degree from the Mount Sinai School of Medicine in New York City. After training in internal medicine at Montefiore Hospital in New York, he completed a residency in dermatology at New York University Medical Center in 1986 and has been in practice for more than 30 years. He is a member of the President's Council of the National Psoriasis Foundation and is active in performing clinical research studies on psoriasis. He has consistently been voted the top doctor in dermatology in the state of New Hampshire for the past decade. Our topic today is about skin cancer and how to protect and care for your skin. Welcome, Dr. Posnick. We're so pleased to have you here to do this very informative program.
Okay, thanks for the introduction. Yeah.
And let's begin by talking about skin cancer and its prevalence.
Okay, sure. Well, skin cancer is actually the number one cancer in the country. In fact, there are more cases of skin cancer than all other cancers combined.
Really?
We divide skin cancer into two categories, mm-hmm. melanoma, which everyone is familiar with, and then non-melanoma skin cancer, which comprises basal cell cancer, squamous cell cancer, and other rarer forms of skin cancer.
Now, let's not just assume everybody may be aware of it. Melanoma right. means what?
It's a cancerous, basically a cancerous mole. The melanocytes are dividing in a haphazard way, in an abnormal way, and those cells have the potential to spread to other parts of the body and cause fatality and cause death.
So that is more common?
That's the least common cancer,
okay.
but the most serious.
The most serious.
So again, we divide the cancers into non-melanoma skin cancers, okay. which are more common, such as basal cell and squamous cell cancer, which
okay.
we'll get into,
very good.
And versus melanoma.
Okay.
So in terms of non-melanoma skin cancers, there are over a million cases a year in this country of non-melanoma skin cancer. Which again is basal cell and squamous cell cancer. Again, that's more than all other cancers combined.
Does it matter the climate or anything like that, that more of that will occur?
It does. We see a lot more of it in the southeast and the southwest, where it's a sunnier climate. But we have a lot of it in New England as well, mostly because we have a Caucasian population here.
Okay.
And so they're more prone to the development of skin cancer. So again, there are more than a million cases of non-melanoma skin cancers per year in this country. Only about 60,000 to 70,000 cases of melanoma. So melanoma is less common than non-melanoma skin cancer, but has the potential to be more deadly. So of the 70,000 or so cases of melanoma each year, about 10,000 of those will die, will be fatal. Of the non-melanoma skin cancers, of which there are a million, only about 3,000 of those will prove to be fatal. So again, the more common skin cancers are not as serious, but melanoma is the one that we worry about the most.
Treatable at different stages and length of being able to live through it, depending upon the type of cancer that it is and the treatments provided?
Yes. So what I'd like to get into first is what exactly causes skin cancer.
Excellent.
So again, in terms of the different types, I just put a slide up. Of the non-melanoma skin cancers, 80% of those are basal cell cancer, which is the most common type and the least serious. It's the most easily treated, as you were alluding to.
Yes.
Squamous cell cancer comprises about 16% of the cancers we see, so not as common as basal cell. A little more serious, it does have the potential to spread and metastasize, but usually not, fortunately. And then melanoma makes up about 4% of the cancers that we see, and that's the one that has the greatest potential for fatality. And then, in addition, we see a lesion called an actinic keratosis, which is a precursor to skin cancer, usually a precursor to squamous cell cancer. And there are about 10 million of those cases per year in this country.
Wow. Are we finding that that's increasing?
It is.
It is.
And we'll get to that.
Okay.
So in terms of the pathogenesis of non-melanoma skin cancer, mm-hmm. It's sunlight. Here we see a picture of the skin. cross-section picture of the skin, and UVA radiation, which is sunlight. And the skin, you know, our bodies in general are remarkable, and our skin is a remarkable immune organ. So when sunlight hits our skin, it actually inhibits our immune system. It has an inhibitory effect on our immune system. It also inhibits a gene called the P53 suppressor gene. We have a gene in our body called the P53 suppressor gene that suppresses skin cancers, or suppresses cancers in general, and if it recognizes the cell as being abnormal, it tries to destroy that cell, which is pretty amazing phenomenon. So when ultraviolet light hits our skin, not only is it suppressing the immune system, it's also causing breaks in our DNA. So I want to get to the next slide, which shows our DNA is made up of nucleotides called purines and pyrimidines. I don't want to get too technical about it, but basically there are two different purines, adenine and guanine, and two pyrimidines, thymine and cytosine. And one purine attaches to one pyrimidine, and you can see the pairing groups on the slide. So guanine pairs with cytosine, and adenine pairs with thymine, and that's normal. That makes up our DNA of every cell in our body. However, when sunlight hits our skin, you get what are called thymine dimers, where thymine attaches to thymine. That's an irregularity in the DNA, and that leads to cancer. Fortunately, what that P53 suppressor gene does is it recognizes that as being abnormal, and it'll either destroy the cell itself, and that's actually what a sunburn is. A sunburn is a peeling of abnormal skin cells. Mm. It's not just that they've been cooked. The DNA is irregular in those, and the skin is, and the body's getting rid of those cells so they don't become cancerous.
See.
So a sunburn's not a good thing to have,
no.
But it is a way of getting rid of these abnormal cells. So what this P53 suppressor gene does is it stimulates the immune system to destroy these cells, either directly or indirectly. Directly, it's a process called apoptosis, where the cell just dies. Indirectly, it sends out, there's another enzyme we have in our body called DNA polymerase, which attacks the abnormal strands of the DNA and actually cuts out the abnormal parts and replaces it with normal parts. It's really pretty remarkable.
That is remarkable. Now, I just want to interject. What about the need for vitamin D that comes from sunlight? How much sunlight is needed to help in that realm, and then how much do we need to make sure we don't get more of in order to cause problems with our skin?
Right. We don't really need that much vitamin D. They say about 20 minutes a day of sun exposure is more than adequate for vitamin D production.
Okay.
That is a good point. Vitamin D is produced in our skin.
Yes.
You have to have sunlight for vitamin D. Alternatively, you can get vitamin D in your diet.
Okay.
It's rich in certain foods like haddock, salmon, or you could take a pill with vitamin D. We're here in New England, and we have about 5 months of almost no daylight. And so many people here are vitamin D deficient in the wintertime.
Okay.
There's no place to get sun here in the winter. Well, today's a nice day, but usually there's no place to get sun here in the winter.
But you're saying 20 minutes of sun a day on average is safe.
Is safe.
It's when you go beyond that.
Beyond that.
That
right.
You're in the realm of creating a potentially cancerous situation.
And vitamin D is a fat soluble. There are vitamins that are water soluble and vitamins that are fat soluble.
Okay.
So most vitamins are water soluble, which means that the day you take them in is the same day you eliminate them, usually from peeing them out in the urine.
Mm-hmm.
The fat soluble vitamins, there are only four, A, D, E, and K. They get stored in your body.
Okay.
So you can store up enough vitamin D from exposure over the summer that kind of carries you through the winter. Although having said that, again, in the winter, we have long winters here with very little daylight. So many people in New England do tend to be vitamin D deficient. So I tell all my patients that they should take vitamin D supplements in the wintertime, at least 1,000 units a day of vitamin D as a pill or in their diet.
Very good. That's very helpful information.
Oh, thanks. So you're right. You do need vitamin D, but you don't want to overdo this, to get too much sun.
Right.
So like I said, this P53 suppressor gene activates the DNA repair process, as you're showing on the slide. It holds the cell until it can be repaired, and then it lets the cell go free and continue replicating normally. Any cells that can't be repaired, they go through this process called apoptosis, which basically means cell death, and it's shed as a sunburn. So like I said, it's pretty remarkable.
That is remarkable.
Immune mechanism. If it can't be repaired, and sun damage tends to be cumulative over a lifetime, so that's where we tend to see a lag between. Because you could ask, well, if you get a sunburn when you're 8 years old, why don't you get cancer then? Well, you don't, because sun damage tends to be cumulative. That damage becomes additive over time. And over time, the body's immune system becomes less active. So that surveillance system that we have, kind of like our homeland security of the body, isn't as active as we get older as it is when we're younger.
So when is the most common time that we see that skin cancer it becomes
usually
showing
its
signs?
In the 40s.
In the 40s.
Is when we start to see a lot of it. We have seen skin cancers in teenagers,
really?
Particularly melanoma. But usually we see it most commonly in people in their late 30s or 40s when we see the most of them. But melanoma is actually the most common malignancy in women between the ages of, I think it's 20 and 26.
And why is that?
Genetics probably plays a role. No one really knows.
No one
it
really
just
knows.
Is. And then after 26 or so, breast cancer overtakes melanoma as a more common malignancy. But in the young female, melanoma is actually the number one malignancy.
Interesting.
So again, getting into the different types of skin cancers, again, basal cell is the most common, and it's definitely due to ultraviolet exposure, mm-hmm. as is squamous cell cancer. Mm-hmm. For melanoma, it's a little more controversial, because basal cell cancers and squamous cell cancers usually we see on sun-exposed areas. Melanomas we often see on non-sun-exposed areas, so it's a question of whether sunlight really is playing a role with melanoma or not. It does, and we know that tanning increases your risk of melanoma, mm-hmm. but genetics plays a role too.
And that tanning is not only sun-related, but also people who go into sun tanning booths?
Yes. So there's different wavelengths of light emitted by sunlight. There's ultraviolet A, B, and C. Ultraviolet C doesn't really hit the Earth's surface. That's blocked by the ozone layer.
Okay.
So we are exposed to ultraviolet A and B. And B, to make it simple, UVB are the burning rays.
Okay.
So that's a shorter wavelength, like 280 to 320 nanometers of light. That burns your skin. UVA are the so-called tanning rays. That's what the tanning salons all use, UVA, and they always tout it as being safer because it doesn't burn the skin, but it's not safer because actually UVA penetrates deeper in the skin.
Really?
UVA burns the skin, but UVA penetrates deeper. It doesn't cause a burn, but it actually causes DNA damage further down in the skin.
My
it actually
goodness.
Makes you more prone to melanoma.
Really?
Also, UVA, well, both wavelengths of light will age the skin. So I tell all my patients, you know, when you're seeing an 18 or a 19-year-old, they're not worried about skin cancer because they figure, well, I'm not going to get that till I'm older. I don't want to think about that. Ugh. But one thing they should think about, at least besides that, is aging of the skin, which starts at a very early age.
Yes.
And sunlight ages the skin. UVA in particular will cause rapid wrinkling of the skin. You'll get brown spots on the skin. All of that is due to sun damage. And it's much easier to prevent that than to undo it.
Okay, and we're going to be speaking about prevention shortly.
Further on, right.
Okay.
So another population that I wanted to bring out is, on the slide it's listed as OTR. That stands for the organ transplant patients.
Yes.
Patients that have undergone organ transplant or put on drugs so they don't, to prevent them from rejecting the transplanted organ, be it kidney, heart, or whatever, those drugs make them much more prone to development of skin cancer.
Really?
So those patients in particular have to be...
Very diligent.
Yeah, and have good surveillance.
Yes.
They have, in fact, 65 times the risk of developing squamous cell cancer compared to someone who hasn't had a transplant, and 10 times the risk of basal cell cancer.
And so do their doctors who are taking care of the other types of things with them, are they aware of this and work hand in hand with the dermatologist to help protect the patient?
They do. A lot of our referrals come from the transplant doctors because they're aware of that.
Very good.
But first we'll talk about actinic keratoses, which is just a precancerous lesion, but again, there are 10 million cases a year of that in this country. Usually occurs on sun-exposed skin. Actinic is another word for solar. It means from the sun.
Okay.
It occurs on sun-exposed areas, so typically we see them on the face, backs of the hands, in the case of a man, a balding scalp.
How about the ears?
In a man, because men tend to have shorter hair.
Yes.
And I'm glad you brought that out, because women have long hair that protects their ears.
Right. Some of them shorter, too.
Yeah, true. But men also tend to wear baseball caps a lot, which do not protect the ears.
Right.
So baseball caps are great for protecting the front of the face because it has the bill
the
in
forehead.
The front.
Yeah.
But it doesn't protect the ears. So for the ears, they really need a hat that has like a brim all around, like at least a 2-inch brim that'll protect their ears, or make sure they use a lot of sunscreen on their ears.
Okay.
So more important for men, but women, some women too that have short hair need to protect their ears as well.
And it's interesting, even little babies. You want to start that process with them having hats and everything else to protect that. And I know we're going to get into that further, but it's very interesting on the precautions you can take that aren't as difficult, like a hat.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I always tell people the best sun protection is avoidance and clothing.
Yes.
And by clothing, we mean a hat, too.
Okay.
And particularly in the case of infants, which we'll get into later, but infants under 6 months of age should not be using sunscreen, but it should be sun avoidance is the key. Because these are chemicals. I mean, they're safe for adults and infants. It's a little bit of a different issue.
Okay.
So actinic keratoses, again, you see it more in fair-skinned people. They present as little rough, dry patches on the skin that people might think it's just a dry patch. So moisturize it. If it goes away, then it was just dry. If it doesn't go away, then it's a growth that needs attention.
To see a dermatologist.
And they should see that. Yeah. And if you don't attend to it, slowly it will progress over time to a squamous cell cancer, but slowly. So if someone finds one on their skin, they don't need to call emergently and feel that it needs to be treated, you know, yesterday. These things take years to develop into cancer, but they should have it addressed.
But if they're caught early enough, it could prevent
it. It's easier to treat.
Very good.
Definitely. And this shows some pictures of actinic keratoses. And again, they appear just little white or reddish flaky areas on the skin.
Yes.
Again, usually the sun exposed
areas. That's right on the hand there.
That's the back of the hand, and the picture next to it is a bald scalp.
And so men or women who have bald scalps, they also are at a higher risk. So they need to protect their scalp by making sure that they're...
They keep it covered with sunscreen or a hat.
Or a scarf.
Right. Yeah. So if actinic keratoses are not treated, it can progress to squamous cell cancer, which can be a deadly cancer. Those can metastasize. Again, usually they're seen on sun-exposed skin. The ones that tend to metastasize are ones on mucous membranes. The skin actually is pretty tough.
Okay.
So for skin cancer to metastasize, takes a while for it to erode through into the blood vessels. But if you have a squamous cell cancer on mucous membrane, meaning like the lip, those can metastasize much quicker.
Aha, and I see the picture of the nose there.
That's the nose, right.
So that also is an area where it develops more quickly?
Because of more sun exposure, and that's an area that's difficult to treat as well. Because again, you know, if someone has a cancer on their cheek, you can imagine it's fairly easy to cut that out and sew the skin together.
Surely.
On the nose, there's not a lot of skin to pull back together.
No.
So sometimes it might require a graft or other procedures.
Graft is when you take skin from another part of the body and place it on that area.
Kind of like a patch on a tire kind of thing.
Yes, okay.
But there are special type of surgeons called Mohs surgeons that we'll talk about later, who are excellent at dealing with cancers on the face.
All right.
So again, these are squamous cell cancers are locally invasive, and they lead to a lot of tissue destruction. So again, the earlier you treat it, when it's in a smaller stage, the less the defect. And very often it can be excised with almost no defect when it's in a small stage. If it's larger, then it's a bigger issue.
We're going to be showing people what to look for and how to examine themselves.
Basal cell cancer is the most common type and the easiest to treat, and also very slow growing, and also definitely due to sun exposure. And here we have some pictures of different types of basal cell cancer, the most common type being like the nodular type. You see by the
little black
nose.
Dot by the nose right there.
Mm-hmm.
It's often raised.
Raised and nodular, like a little raised bump.
Okay.
There's also a superficial type, which is more like a flat red patch on the skin, which is the second picture.
Uh-huh.
And then lastly, there's a morpheiform type, which looks just like a scar on the skin.
Interesting.
And very often, if we have a patient that comes in, they have what looks like a scar on their cheek or somewhere in the body, we'll ask them, how did you get that scar? And if they don't have a good reason for having the scar, then it is a cancer, but it raises a red flag that maybe this lesion needs to be biopsied and make sure it's not a cancer.
And on all of those forms, how long does it take to actually develop it? How does it begin to present? Is it like a little thinking that you may have a little acting or a little posture, a little spot?
That's a good point. Well, all cancers start as one cell, and it just divides. So it takes a while for that. So they do start small, you know, an eighth of an inch or less.
Okay.
And they grow relatively slowly. But certainly, if you see a lesion getting larger, and if it hits like 6 millimeters or more, that's when it definitely should be addressed if it's not going away on its own.
Okay.
Yeah. Here we see pictures of the different lesions. On the first slide shows the precancerous actinic keratoses.
Yes.
Which are kind of these scaly lesions on this gentleman's nose.
Okay.
Then we see this gentleman's ear, which shows a squamous cell cancer. Mm-hmm. And the ear, too, is a tricky area to try to repair. Not a lot of
very thin skin,
and it's right over the cartilage. Mm-hmm. And cancers tend to spread quickly over cartilage. So you want to treat those quickly.
Okay.
And then we see a nodular basal cell on this gentleman's upper cutaneous lip, which, again, looks just, that's the nodular type. It looks like just a pearly little bump on the skin. It just doesn't heal.
Now, interesting enough, in this process, would these patients or clients in any way before, when they were younger, had acne or anything going on in their skin or anything that would predispose them to have something like this happen?
That's an excellent point. I was a dermatology resident from 83 to 86. I'm going to date myself a little bit. I looked much younger than my stated age, so it doesn't matter.
Absolutely.
So back in the, when I was a resident, we saw a lot of skin cancers on people's faces who had a lot of acne scarring. And 20 years previously, those same people back in, I guess it was the 1960s, were receiving x-ray treatments for acne. And that was a common treatment for acne back in the 1960s. We didn't have a lot in our armamentarium. We had tetracycline, doxycycline as an antibiotic.
Yes.
We had benzoyl peroxide.
Yes.
We didn't have, you know, the retinoids we have today. We didn't have drugs like Accutane like we have today for acne.
Yes.
So one of the treatments for bad cystic acne back then was radiation, x-ray treatments.
Wow.
And it did work for acne. Mm-hmm. It worked for other things too. It was used for fungus. It's still used to some extent to treat skin cancers.
Okay.
But it also causes skin cancer. And it would cause thyroid cancer. Patients that received x-ray treatment for acne in the 60s were at higher risk of developing thyroid cancers, you know, 20 or 30 years later. And that's true of the history of medicine, though. Treatments that, you know, were hailed as state-of-the-art, you know, in their time,
yes.
We found 20 or 30 years later that they had certain side effects that were not known at the time that these treatments were being used.
And the medicine has evolved so quickly in a lot of ways.
It has.
Very true.
But that's an excellent point you make. So mm-hmm. Did these people have, some of them did, and if they were treated with x-ray years ago, that predisposes them to skin cancer.
So for any of our listeners that may have had that or whatever
right.
else, they should just be a little more aware that that's
right.
something to discuss with their doctor.
And those patients are still out there.
Right, they are.
Know,
that's why I'm bringing it up.
Now they're in their 60s and 70s,
exactly,
but they're still
but
there.
Exactly, but they may not know,
right.
and this is important information for
right.
them.
Excellent point. So we'll go to the next slide. So now we'll talk a little bit about melanoma.
Yes.
And melanoma, basically, it looks like a mole, but unlike a normal mole will reach a certain size and stop growing.
Okay.
Melanomas, the DNA is disrupted in them, so they don't stop growing. They
and
continue
they're
to grow.
They're raised?
They start flat.
They start flat.
But they will get raised over time.
Mm-hmm.
You actually want to get them when they're still in the flat stage.
Okay.
Because the thicker they are, that portends a worse prognosis.
And so it will present as a dark patch.
Patch that's enlarging in size.
And
or has an irregular shape.
An irregular shape.
Right. Or has irregular color,
okay.
as we'll see.
Okay.
And so in terms of epidemiology, mm-hmm. You'll see there's a big change over, since the 1935 till the 2000s in terms of developing risk of developing melanoma.
Yes, definitely
and
has increased.
It's increased dramatically. For several sociological reasons. Historically, back at the turn of the century, we're in a different century now, so back in the early 1900s,
mm-hmm.
It was not fashionable to have a tan.
Right.
If you had a tan, it meant you were a laborer,
right.
and that was looked down upon years ago. It meant you were a farmer working out in the field, or mm-hmm. you did manual labor, as opposed to someone who worked indoors in a white-collar job, that was considered more prestigious. And those people didn't want to have a tan because if you had a tan, it pretended that you were of the lower classes back then. And that all changed around in the 1920s. The 1920s, Coco Chanel
yes.
of Chanel
yeah.
Took a trip to the French Riviera
mm-hmm.
and came back with a tan. And she made tanning fashionable, which was not a good thing to happen.
Mm-hmm.
They
didn't know better.
They didn't know better.
Mm-hmm.
And back then, at the turn of the century, turn of that century, rickets was a problem as well.
Now, what are rickets?
Vitamin D deficiency.
And how did that present?
Children would have bowed legs.
Ah.
Like we see, you don't see that anymore, thank God,
no.
but children had bowing of their legs because
okay.
of vitamin D deficiency.
Mm-hmm. Treatable?
And so, treatable with vitamin D.
Yes.
And the cheapest form of vitamin C is sunlight.
Exactly.
So kids were told to go out and get sun. That was a good thing.
Vitamin
treated,
C or vitamin D?
I'm sorry, vitamin D.
Yes.
So that would treat their rickets.
Mm-hmm.
So that was a little bit of an issue as well. But the big thing was Coco Chanel, encouraging the higher classes to now get a tan because it meant that you had money to travel. And so things really changed around 1960. So what happened around 1960? Well, air travel became relatively inexpensive,
mm-hmm.
And we became a very affluent society.
Yes.
You had the baby boomers from World War II.
Right.
And these people had a lot of money now, or at least enough money to travel.
Mm-hmm.
So people started traveling to Florida, to the Caribbean, to California, and people started migrating as well. So before we had air conditioning, everyone lived in the Northeast.
Mm-hmm.
With the advent of air conditioning, people started moving south. So now you have a lot more people living in Florida, the Southwest, California, Arizona. Again, greatly increases the risk of skin cancer.
Now you were saying that it was more related to Caucasian skin.
Yes.
How about for other skin types? what are the most common things for them, and what should they look out for?
Well, anyone can get skin cancer, but it is more common in Caucasians. The more pigment you have in your skin, the more protection you have.
That's important.
So, black-skinned individuals,
yes,
they can get skin cancer, usually on their palms and soles, where they have less pigment.
Okay.
But they can get it anywhere in the body.
And their skin can also burn, correct?
Less likely to, again,
likely.
Because they have more melanin.
Okay.
The more melanin you have, the more protection you have.
But they should still be using suntan screen?
They should.
Okay.
Everyone should.
All right.
Exactly.
Very good. And
that's another good point. The highest incidence of melanoma in the world is in Australia.
Aha, and why is that?
Because you have a transplanted population. Australia was originally a prison colony from England. They would stick their prisoners there.
Uh-huh.
So you have the Celtic Caucasian population in a climate where they were never meant to be.
Wow.
And of course, there were no sunscreens back then,
yes,
when they first were brought there in the 1800s. And so they have the highest rate of skin cancer and melanoma in the world.
The entire world.
Yeah.
Wow.
And in this country, the highest rate is in Arizona and Florida. Same thing, because you have people who've retired there and transplanted there.
Yes.
And they get exposed to the sun.
And so for some of them that have transplanted, they may have done it later on in their years, but it's catching up with them that quickly that they will see the skin cancer forming?
Well, that's a good point also.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, they did studies years ago looking at when people migrated to certain countries.
Okay.
And if you migrated before a certain age, I think it was before 18 or 12,
yes,
you basically retain the characteristics of where you migrated from. So if you migrated after the age of 12 or 18,
okay,
your risk of developing cancer was more aligned with where you came from. If you migrated at a younger age, then it was obviously it was the risk of where you moved to.
Yes.
Right. So if you migrate at a later age, it's actually better for you. The younger you migrate out, the worse it is for you. The later you migrate out, you retain the characteristics of where you moved from.
But it's an important awareness statistically,
right,
related to the choices that you make.
Or your family mix for you.
Exactly, that's true.
But now we know, there's a quote from Darwin that the species that survives,
yes,
is not the smartest or the strongest, it's the one most able to adapt. And that's the origin of the species. That's Charles Darwin.
Yes.
And that's absolutely true. Ways to deal with this. We,
yes,
know how to prevent skin cancer.
And we know how to
so
take
we know
care
how to
of
adapt.
Skin.
Right.
So
exactly.
There are things that we can be proactive about,
right,
to make a difference in our outcomes.
Exactly. So we know how to deal with that today. But of course, 100 years ago, those things were not known.
Yes, and we're going to be reviewing them shortly.
Right. But the incidence of melanoma continues to increase. Like I said, in the year 2000, 1 in 74 Americans developed melanoma. Now it's actually 1 in 50.
So environmentally, that must have an impact also.
It does. There's other factors. Well, the depletion of the ozone layer probably,
exactly,
plays a role.
Yes.
I also think, personally, it's just my opinion, but I think that all of the nuclear testing that was performed in the 1940s and,
yes,
50s and 60s,
yes,
all of that, when they exploded nuclear bombs for testing purposes back then, that was released into the atmosphere.
Absolutely.
And it definitely played a role in our DNA. Mm-hmm. I was watching a show on that recently on one of the PBS stations, and they said that if you exhume skeletons prior to, I think it was 1940, there's almost no radiation in their bones. If you look at people that died since 1960, the amount of radiation in our bones is at a very high level, and it's felt to be from nuclear testing that was done back in the 40s and 50s, because it's released into the atmosphere, and it doesn't disappear. It's always there some extent.
Very interesting.
Yeah, which is, I find that fascinating.
Yes.
But that's just my opinion.
No, it is interesting.
So hopefully we'll be getting more nuclear testing going on.
So from New Hampshire's point of view, where we are compared to the whole country, I know you have this whole schematic. Where do,
right,
we fall?
We're actually okay. Like I said, the highest mortality rates for melanoma is in the southeast in Florida,
mm-hmm,
and in the southwest in California. But if you look, Vermont actually is a red area,
yes,
which means it's a relatively high mortality rate percentage-wise.
And why would that be?
Because it's a Caucasian population.
Even
though we don't have a lot of sun here,
yes,
we have a very high, white population,
okay,
and they do travel. They traveled on vacation to the Caribbean and other places, and so they're getting their sun exposure, and they're going tanning, too.
And it's interesting. Are you seeing more males getting it or more females or about equal?
It's a, It's about equal, but we tend to find it in women sooner because I think they're more vigilant in keeping an eye on changes on their skin.
Okay, because your statistic here says about white males.
Yeah, because with white males, they tend to delay going to the dermatologist. Females
let alone
tend to
the doctor.
Yes, they tend to delay going to a doctor, period,
right.
Which is a bad thing.
And that's why
right.
The women in their life need to encourage them to take good care of themselves and go.
That's true. Mm-hmm. And here, too, getting to your point, most of the new melanoma cases are in men, not by a huge difference, but significantly more men die of melanoma than women, again, because they wait till it's a little too long before they see the doctor.
And probably these are statistics going back to 2004.
It's higher
much
now.
More.
Right.
Yes.
Now the 55,000 number is actually 70,000.
Really?
And the other numbers would go up accordingly.
Okay.
Yeah. So the key, as we were talking about earlier, is early recognition.
Okay.
And then risk factors. If there's a family history of melanoma, that portends a higher risk as well.
So you need to be more diligent.
Right. So if one family member has melanoma, one first-degree relative has melanoma, which a first-degree relative would be a parent or a sibling or a child, then that raises their risk about tenfold. So if every American has about a 1%, actually a little higher than 1% risk of getting melanoma, if a family member has it, that raises that risk about 10%, which means there's still a 90% chance they will not get melanoma. So the odds are still in their favor, but they do have a much higher risk of potentially developing melanoma than someone without a family history.
All right.
So that's key. Skin type plays a role. So again, people with very fair skin are at higher risk of melanoma than those with darker skin because we don't have as much melanin in our skin. The best skin type to have probably overall is probably olive-complected skin. We have a little mixture of everything.
That's what the more Mediterranean?
More Mediterranean type, in terms of skin cancer. Environmentally, if you have more than 3 blistering sunburns before age 20, that increases your risk. And who are the people that tan the most? The teenagers.
Yes.
So again, the tanning rays might not burn the skin, but they're still causing damage in the DNA. So we're definitely against tanning. Now, having said that, as a dermatologist, I do want to say that we use ultraviolet light therapeutically for certain skin diseases. We use it for psoriasis and for atopic dermatitis therapeutically. That's different. However, we're monitoring how much ultraviolet light the patient is receiving, and we're using it in therapeutic doses. We're not using it for cosmetic uses.
Okay.
Also, people who have worked in outdoor summer jobs, particularly lifeguarding, increases their risk for skin cancer. Again, use of sun lamps and tanning beds should be forbidden unless medically necessary. And then if people that have a lot of freckling on their skin, freckles themselves are benign, but they're a sign of sun damage. You don't get freckles there are two types of freckles. It's the freckles people are
born with
genetically, those are okay. Those are perfectly okay. But the freckles you get from sun damage, those are not normal.
Okay.
They're not cancerous, they're not precancerous, but they're a sign of sun damage. Mm-hmm. You don't get freckles if you don't. If you look at people that have a lot of freckles on their skin, they have them on their face, the back of the hands. If you look at the sun-protected areas, like the buttocks or the abdomen, where they never have sun, there are no freckles there.
And what about the red spots that occur? This is part of normal aging?
Well, that can be genetic also.
Okay.
Like angiomas are genetic.
Okay.
But broken blood vessels on the skin, like telangiectasia, that's from sun damage.
Okay.
So that's a good point, too. Mm-hmm. And each risk factor, as it says, increases risk additively. So if you have a genetic predisposition, if you have fair skin, if you go in the sun a lot, you're kind of...
Raising your odds.
You're raising your risk. Yeah, exactly. And so when we look at moles, a mole should be perfectly round, well, not perfectly round, but it should be almost perfectly round and uniform in color and symmetrical. So here we see pictures of an asymmetrical dark lesion. Mm-hmm. Doesn't mean it's cancerous. Each of these factors by itself does not mean that the lesion is cancerous, but it's a warning sign.
Okay.
And if someone has an irregular mole like that, we'd probably end up biopsying it. But it doesn't mean it's going to be cancer. Many of these still come back benign when we test them, fortunately. Mm-hmm. So you want them to be symmetrical, not asymmetrical.
Right.
You want it to have a smooth border, not a jagged border, as we see for the bee. Mm-hmm. Moles can be different colors. You can have two moles next to each other. One can be dark, one can be lighter in color. But each mole should be only one color.
Okay.
You shouldn't see different shades of color within the same mole.
Okay.
So by color, like I said, if it's different colors within the same mole, that's a warning sign. Doesn't mean it's cancer, but that's a warning sign.
And what causes a mole?
Genetics mostly, and sun exposure. Sun will cause more moles to form on the skin. A mole is basically a tumor. It's a tumor of melanocytes, but it's a benign tumor. I have a mole on my chin.
Okay.
But it's a benign mole. This is basically a benign tumor.
So
it's a tumor of melanocytes, but you don't need to remove it. It's perfectly round. It's symmetrical.
So there are healthy moles, and then there are other moles that are questionable or other moles that need to be removed.
Exactly. Okay. And most moles are perfectly benign.
And when they do need to be removed, are they removed surgically?
Yes. Yeah, surgically, definitely. There are different ways of removing them,
okay.
But the only proper way to remove it is surgically. Because that's the only way you can send it to the lab to be analyzed.
All right.
We look at the size of a mole. Most benign lesions will reach a certain size and stop growing. Mm-hmm. Most, not all. Cancerous lesions continue to grow. So if it's more than 6 millimeters, again, it raises a red flag. It doesn't mean it's cancerous, but it raises a red flag. And lastly, we look at evolution. Moles should be pretty static. If they're changing in size or shape or color, again, that's a warning sign. And here we see different pictures of melanomas.
Mm.
So the first one's more of a superficial spreading type, which is flat.
Yes.
And that's kind of the stage you want to treat it at, where it doesn't have any thickness, so
okay.
It would be easily curable. Mm-hmm. When it's a nodular type, those have greater thickness. The greater the thickness, the greater the potential for the lesion to metastasize.
Okay.
Because we sort of assume that whatever the thickness is above the skin, it's probably going down under the skin as well, kind of like an iceberg.
So let me ask you, related to the nodular ones, could they be misinterpreted related to skin tags? What's the difference between skin tags and nodular?
Well, skin tags can be darkly pigmented, but usually they're attached by a very fine stalk.
Okay.
They don't have like a broad base to them.
Aha.
So if it has a broad base, then I'd start to worry about it.
Okay.
Lentigo maligna is also another superficial type of melanoma, usually seen on the face. Usually it looks like a freckle on the face. It just starts getting larger and more irregular in shape and color.
Okay.
Aquilentiginous. Aquil means it's on the hands or the feet. Mm-hmm. So again, that's where you definitely want to look in someone who has darker pigmented skin, like
yes.
It mentions Asians or black
and sometimes
reflected
underneath
people,
the nail beds.
Underneath the nail as well, exactly. And we very often will have patients come in with a black spot under their nail.
Yes.
And the first thing we ask them is about trauma. You know, did you...
Right, did it get caught?
Right, because the first thing we think about when we see that is blood under the nail, which
right.
is okay.
Yes.
Blood under the nail is perfectly fine, and if
yes.
it is blood under the nail, it will grow out over time. You'll see like a little black dot like at the base of the nail.
Yes.
But over the next few months, it'll be growing out with the nail.
Mm-hmm.
If it's a melanoma, it will not grow out with the nail.
Okay.
So when we do see that and a patient is frantic about it, we say, look, we really don't want to biopsy your nail bed because it's
okay.
a very painful thing to do.
Oh, I can imagine.
So we'll give it some time, unless we're suspicious from day one.
Right.
Sometimes we are. But if we're not suspicious and we think it's just hemorrhage from trauma, then we'll just watch it and save the patient the pain and discomfort of a biopsy there.
Very good.
And lastly, there's a rarer type called a desmoplastic melanoma, which sometimes it doesn't even have any pigment to it. And those can be difficult to pick up. Mm. And those tend to be fairly aggressive as well. And I think these are just some pictures of different melanomas here. So I'll just go through them slowly. If anyone has anything that looks like this on their skin, they should see their doctor immediately.
Okay.
None of these are good.
So the first thing should they be doing is going to their primary care doctor,
yes.
or should they be requesting an appointment with a dermatologist?
Either would be okay.
Okay.
So
if anyone sees anything looking like
this,
that,
they should
need
see
to
their
call
doctor immediately.
Doctor. Yes, immediately.
Or their provider immediately, nurse mm-hmm. practitioner, whoever they
yes.
normally see.
Their
would
primary
be fine.
Care provider.
Primary care provider. But here, I mean, this is a classic one. You see it's irregular in shape.
Yes.
It's even bleeding a little bit in the
yes.
center. That's not a normal looking lesion. So in terms of survival does correlate with the thickness of the melanoma.
Okay.
That's why if you can catch it in a flat stage,
yes.
those have the best survival rates.
Mm-hmm.
Also, we look at whether the lesion is ulcerated or not. If it's ulcerated, it tends to have a worse prognosis as well.
Does it spread?
It does spread. Melanoma is one of the most aggressive cancers because it can spread either directly through the skin, it can spread through the bloodstream, or it can spread through the lymphatic system.
And that's why the rate of survival
goes down dramatically as the lesion gets thicker. And that's why the most common places for it to metastasize to are lymph nodes. It can go to the lungs, it can go to the liver, ovaries, brain. It can go anywhere in the body because it can metastasize any of several different ways.
And it does so very quickly.
Relatively quickly if you catch a thicker stage. There are newer treatments for melanoma, thank God, that are effective even in the later stages. But again, the earlier the diagnosis is made and the earlier they're treated, the better.
Okay.
In terms of margins for melanoma, when we excise a basal cell or a squamous cell cancer,
yes,
we take a relatively narrow margin of normal skin around it because that's all that's necessary.
And when you say excise, you're taking a particular instrument and just cutting
it
a piece
out,
up.
Right,
yep.
Or destroying it by some method.
Okay.
When it comes to melanoma, the margins are much greater because we're more worried about metastasis in this case.
Okay.
So for a melanoma that's 1 millimeter thick, and a millimeter is almost nothing.
If right,
anyone at home can take out their ruler, one
right,
millimeter
it's really
is tiny.
Yes.
So if it's 1 millimeter thick or less, we're taking a centimeter margin around that. A centimeter is about half an inch margin around that.
Right.
If it's greater than a millimeter, we'll take as much as 2 centimeters around that lesion. So if someone could come in with a lesion that's, you know, relatively tiny, they'll leave with a scar that's not so tiny. So again, when you catch it at the smaller stage, the better the outcome, both in terms of prognosis and in terms of cosmetic outcome as well, and leaving a smaller scar.
How do you look and find the things on your skin? What is the best way to start? And how often should people be checking their skin and their bodies?
Well, usually we recommend monthly,
okay,
self-examination monthly.
Okay.
But again, that depends on the age of the person as well.
Okay.
Obviously, for someone, you know, under 18 years of age, you know, skin cancer is not as common in that group. But still, it's not a bad idea for people to get familiar with their body anyway.
All right.
So I think once a month is usually what we recommend.
And the best way to do that is to start by looking in the mirror?
In the mirror, right.
Okay, to start with the face and the head?
Face.
The ears?
Right. The scalp is hard for them to see on their
right.
own, and the back is difficult for them to see on their own. They could try using a second-hand mirror
right.
to reach behind their back, or if they have a partner that can look at it, you know, either their parent or spouse or significant other that can look at their back for them.
And they're looking for spots, anything related to anything different in symmetry
right.
or whatever, as well as what other things
right.
should
we
they
use,
be looking
well,
for?
Well, we use what's called the ugly duckling sign
okay,
in,
let's
in
talk
dermatology.
About that. Right.
So, because we have, there's something else that I don't have photos of, but there's some people that have a lot of what are called atypical moles or dysplastic moles.
Yes.
And that's actually fairly common. And those are moles that look irregular. They don't fit the criteria of being a normal mole. They might be larger in size or have an irregular shape to them, but they're still benign. And so we have patients that sometimes have dozens of those types of moles, and we're not going to remove dozens of moles from somebody that,
mm-hmm.
that are benign.
Yes.
So we have what's called the ugly duckling sign, which means you look for the mole that looks different from everything else.
All right.
So if they have 30 moles, and they're all slightly irregular, but they all look the same, pretty much, we know they're all benign. They're
okay.
not going to have 30 cancers at one time. It just doesn't happen that
okay.
way. But if one looks a little darker than the rest, or just stands out, you look at, you're scanning their skin, and you say, this one just looks different than the others,
okay.
that's what you look for. That's the one you're going to biopsy.
All right. So people should be starting from their head, having
and
somebody look
down.
At the and working
right.
all the way down the body,
and
looking
look at their
at
palms
every
and soles
part, the
as
palms
well.
And soles,
right.
in between their
in
fingers,
between the, right.
in between their toes, top
right.
of feet, bottom, all down the legs, everywhere, literally.
Right.
And get somebody else or with a mirror to look at the back,
back.
Of your body. And to start in your teenage years?
I would recommend that, sure.
Yes, just to find out what's normal.
Right. And once a month, it takes just a couple of minutes. It's not a long thing to do. And
right.
they do it when they're in the shower. Before they take the shower, they can do it, or after the shower, whichever they prefer.
And I know at the end of the show, we're going to have a website for people to go to so that they can actually get a copy of information
right.
on how to keep track of what you find on your body and what to look for.
Right, and how to perform a self-examination.
And to how to perform a
right.
self-examination. Because this is really important because
right.
you can catch something.
Right, and when they go for their yearly physical with their primary care provider, they'll be looking at their skin as well.
Okay, so that is normal as part of the annual
physical,
exam?
Right. Their primary care will look them over as
okay.
well.
Right.
But again, they're only looking at that person at one point in time.
Exactly.
Which is why, even when I see the patient, you know, I might see something that looks a little suspicious to me. I'll say to the patient, well, how long have you had this particular lesion? Has this changed over time?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm seeing them at one point in time. I didn't see them 2 months ago or 6 months ago or a year ago or even 5 years ago.
That's right. So the best person to be an expert on their own
themselves.
Body is themselves.
Right, exactly. And then in terms of if we are suspicious about a lesion, then we would biopsy it.
Okay.
And there's different methods of biopsy. In some cases, we'll actually just, if we're very suspicious, we'll excise the lesion right at the very first visit.
Yes.
If we're not as suspicious, then we might just do what's called a shave biopsy, which is less invasive. Mm-hmm. We're just taking part of the lesion, and that usually does not require any stitches, so it leaves less of a scar. So we don't want to leave someone with huge scars on the body if we can avoid it.
Exactly.
If we can take just a small piece of the specimen and leave almost no scar, mm-hmm. or an imperceptible scar, that's preferable, particularly if the lesion turns out to be benign.
Okay.
No one wants to have a big scar and then they're told, well, that lesion was benign. Patients are not happy with that.
No. So the difference in the training, let's say, between a dermatologist and a plastic surgeon related to scars, do you approach it in the same manner related to how you're sewing up what's there so that it can heal well and blend in into the skin?
We do. But I would say we use plastic surgeons a lot. They're great allies of ours.
Okay.
Mostly for the larger lesions. So in terms of smaller lesions, you know, I think dermatologists in general do a fantastic job. I mean, we are the experts on the skin.
Of course.
Plastic surgeons are the experts in repairing the skin.
Very good.
So we work together. So if it's a small lesion and we think we can do a job equal to that of a plastic surgeon, then certainly we do it ourselves.
Okay.
If we think the plastic surgeon will do a better job because it's a larger lesion, mm-hmm. Then we send it right to the plastic surgeon.
Okay.
And like I said, we refer a lot of cases to plastic surgeons because, like I said, you know, we're very conscious of the patient's psyche, and no one wants to have a scar in their
body.
No,
because their self-esteem will be affected.
Exactly.
They'll become very self-conscious and not confident.
Right. Now, having said that, obviously, whenever you move anything, there's always a risk of some scar being there,
right.
And regardless of who does it.
Yes.
But again, we try to take into account location on the body and who would do the better job. And we always send it to whoever would do the best job possible.
That's wonderful.
And then there's a certain class of dermatologists or certain subspecialty of dermatology called Mohs surgery who have special training in surgery. And we have one in our practice.
Okay. What is it called again?
Mohs, M-O-H-S.
M-O-H-S.
It's named after a dermatologist, Dr. Frederick Mohs, who is a dermatologist in Wisconsin. I think he might be still alive even, but back in the 50s and 60s.
Mm-hmm.
And he devised this technique of removing skin cancers with the smallest scar possible.
Okay.
By taking out kind of layer by layer. Instead of taking like a wide margin of skin around the cancer, mm-hmm. taking out just a smaller margin, examining that by frozen section under the microscope, and then if necessary, taking more. It's a much longer procedure, mm-hmm. so it's only reserved for cancers on the face or certain areas like the nose or eyelids or ears. It's not meant for cancers on the trunk or body, just the facial area mostly, or scalp. But it's a technique that these surgeons are trained in to leave the smallest scar possible with the highest cure rate.
That's excellent. Yeah. So have we covered all the major cancers, the malignant and the other aspects of it? What are we missing?
Well, there are some rarer cancers, which I won't go, there's one called a Merkel cell cancer, which is very invasive. There are T-cell lymphomas of the skin, but those are less common, so I don't want to really go into that here. But
so
I do want to just
the treatment modalities.
Go into the treatment modalities quickly. Mm-hmm. So we mentioned Mohs surgery briefly. That's at the top of the list.
Mm-hmm.
That has the highest cure rate for cancers on the face.
Okay.
And like I said, there are dermatologists who are specially trained in that technique, mm-hmm. And they do a great job. And they will remove the tumor. And then based on the size of the defect, they will either repair it themselves or refer it to a plastic surgeon for repair, depending on, again, who they feel will do the best job for the patient. If it's a smaller lesion or a lesion on the trunk as opposed to the face, or even if it's on the face but a smaller lesion, it might just be excised. That just means cutting it out and stitching it closed.
Okay.
If it's a lesion on the trunk or sometimes on the scalp, we can just burn the lesion out. Not a melanoma, but a basal cell or squamous cell can be burned out.
Meaning cauterized?
Cauterized.
Okay,
yeah,
and that's
we numb
a
it
specific
and cauterize it.
Instrument
yeah.
that's used.
Right, it's a curve-shaped scalpel, basically, mm-hmm. a curette that uh-huh. scrapes it out, and then we cauterize it.
Okay.
Radiation is still used for skin cancers.
Okay.
Gives an excellent cure rate. It's only reserved for older people, however.
Why is that?
Because radiation is great at treating, not melanoma, but it's excellent at treating basal cell and squamous cell cancers mm-hmm. Short term. But it gives a great cosmetic result for 10 to 20 years. But 20 years out, you get what's called radiation damage to the skin, where the skin thins out, and can actually develop skin cancer from the radiation, as we mentioned earlier.
Okay.
So usually it's reserved for people who are poor candidates for surgery. You really just want to operate on them because they're on they have a lot of medical issues. They can't tolerate anesthetics, and they can't tolerate being on a table for a long time. So radiation is painless. It's just x-ray treatment. Okay. It requires many treatments. It's usually 8 to 20 treatments, you know, over like a several week period, but it's totally painless.
Is that done in the hospital or in your office?
There are some dermatologists who do it in the office. We do not. Okay. Usually we send them to the cancer centers for that to receive radiation there.
All right.
But there are some dermatologists who do radiation in their office. To do that, they have to, just like when you go to the dentist, you have to have lead-lined walls and so forth.
And
we're not set up for that.
All right.
Most dermatology practices are not set up for that, but some do.
That would be very costly, I'm sure.
Very costly. Mm-hmm. But radiation is great for treating cancers, particularly on the head and neck area in elderly people that are not good candidates for surgery.
Okay.
But again, it's not used that often because most patients are good candidates for surgery nowadays.
Right.
And again, it's only used for older individuals, mm-hmm. like usually over the age of 80.
Okay.
So preventive strategies, we did touch on this a little bit, but education is the key.
Key.
Surveillance also, which goes along with education.
Examining yourself, making sure you routinely look at what is normal for you and what is not.
Right. It says dermatology surveillance. That does not mean dermatologist surveillance.
Right.
It means self-surveillance.
Self-surveillance.
As you mentioned, exactly.
Exactly.
And then you see the dermatologist if something doesn't look right to you.
Yes.
But basically, most of the surveillance is done by the patient themselves and in conjunction with their primary care provider. Mm-hmm. And then photoprotection, which we're going to get into with sunscreens and so forth.
Okay. So why don't we jump into that?
Okay. We'll do
there
this
we
first.
Go. Great. That's what we want to go
into
right
this
to.
As well.
Good.
So the best protection from the sun is
sun avoidance and protection.
Right, and the best protection, in my opinion, is clothing.
Okay,
avoidance and clothing.
So there are certain clothing now on the market that people wear that is supposed to be a better protective barrier. Correct?
Yes, that's true.
Is there anything to that?
There is something to it. They say that a white T-shirt has an SPF of 6 or 8. I didn't do the studies on that, so I can't dispute that per se.
Okay.
But my own opinion is that I have never received a sunburn or a suntan through a white T-shirt.
Right.
So I'm not so sure. I mean, there is sun protection clothing out there that is very effective.
Okay.
In terms, no sun will penetrate that.
And how much?
And that's useful.
One find that.
Oh, online they'd have to buy it. There are certain companies that make it.
Okay.
I think Coolabar is one. There are some other companies.
Okay.
And that's very effective for people that have either allergies to the sun, conditions like lupus, or conditions where they're genetically predisposed to cancer. There are some people who they have what's called basal cell nevus syndrome, or the people that are prone to melanoma. That type of clothing would be very helpful for those people because really no sunlight will penetrate that clothing.
Okay.
But for the average person, I think regular clothing is fine.
All right.
I don't think we need to spend, you know, $40 on a white T-shirt for sun protection. I think a regular T-shirt is fine.
All right.
They say it does depend on the weave of the fabric. Mm-hmm. The tighter the weave, the harder it is for the sun to penetrate, which makes sense. So if you're wearing a very light, gauzy shirt, mm-hmm. obviously you know the sun's going to penetrate through that. Mm-hmm. If it's a tight weave, and you can just hold the shirt up and look
right,
at the fiber.
Right, see if you can see up.
Yeah, mm-hmm. if you can't see through it,
right.
That's a tight weave, the sun's not going to penetrate that.
Okay.
And so for 99% of us, regular clothing is fine.
Okay.
For the small percentage of the population that have photosensitive diseases like, you know, lupus erythematosus mm-hmm. or strong family history of skin cancer, those people I would recommend it's worth them investing in the sun protective clothing,
okay.
you know, which is fairly expensive, but it's very effective.
Mm-hmm.
But for most of us, regular clothing is fine.
And when people go to the beach or the pools and they're out during the summer and it's hot,
right.
What should they be doing related to swimwear, cover-ups, and everything
yes.
else?
Well, the amount of time you spend in the sun is key, too.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't want to be out there for more than a couple of hours maximum. And
okay.
you really want to avoid the sun between 10 and 4,
right.
which is difficult for a lot of people. Because if you're going to spend an hour driving to the beach, you're not going to, you know, you kind of want to be there for a while.
Exactly.
I understand that. But on the other hand, the longer you're out there, the more damage you're doing to your skin.
And just being under an umbrella doesn't necessarily
is not
mean
adequate.
That you're protected.
No, because you're getting reflection from the sand and water as well.
Okay.
So I really tell people to avoid getting more than 2 hours of sun a day, even in the summertime, and using sun protection when they are out there.
So let's talk about sun protection related to sunscreen. There are all different
right.
types of sunscreen on the market
right.
with all different numbers.
Right.
What do you recommend?
Well, we used to recommend... Back when I was a resident, we recommended 15 or higher.
Okay.
Then a few years later, we started recommending 30 or higher.
Right.
We're still pretty much at the 30 or higher category.
Okay.
But a lot of the newer literature is actually recommending SPF of 50 or higher.
50 or
but
higher.
30 or higher still seems to be the gold standard right now.
And are there particular ones that are better than others? What do you look for? You have all these different things out on the market.
all of them out there are pretty good. There are different types of sunscreens, though.
Okay.
There are chemical sunscreens, and then there are physical sunscreens.
So what's the difference?
Physical sunscreens are like when you used to go to the beach years ago, you'd see the lifeguard with that white
zinc
oxide on the skin.
Yes.
That's a physical blocker.
Okay.
So the physical blockers are zinc oxide and titanium dioxide.
Sure.
And those, literally, the sun cannot penetrate that. It's
okay.
A physical blocker.
Okay.
And nowadays, back then, like I said, the lifeguards would use that white cakey material, the zinc oxide.
Okay.
Now the sunscreens we have are more elegant.
Okay.
So there is zinc oxide in more elegant preparations that they don't absorb into the skin. They still sit on top of the skin, so they're a physical blocker.
Okay.
But they're micronized, so they rub into the skin better, so you don't see that white color as much anymore. So they're more cosmetically elegant.
Okay.
So those are physical blockers. Those are actually the best ones to use.
All right.
But they are harder to spread. Even the newer ones are a little harder to spread than the chemical sunscreens.
Mm-hmm.
The chemical sunscreens bind to your skin. They actually bind to the DNA,
mm-hmm.
and they prevent you from getting from. They prevent the sun from damaging your DNA.
Okay.
So they actually penetrate into your skin and protect
Any
you that way.
Any harmful things that they're doing to
no,
the skin and
there,
into,
there
being
are,
absorbed?
That's somewhat controversial. There are some websites that say it's dangerous, but studies have shown that they're not dangerous.
Okay.
That they really don't penetrate deep enough. They should not be used on infants. None of them should be used on infants.
When do you start?
6 months of age or older.
And
is when
are there
start.
Particular types of products that you should use on an infant?
For the kids, I would recommend the physical blockers,
the zinc oxide.
They're safe because they don't get absorbed at all.
Okay.
They just sit on top of the skin.
Very good.
And infant skin is much absorbs things to a much greater extent
okay.
than adult skin.
All right.
So that's why you really don't want to use anything that they can absorb on their skin.
Okay.
So you
so
want the physical
covered
blockers on skin.
Skin. We covered skin screen.
Right, sunscreen,
but sunscreen. But the other thing we talked about is not going into the tanning booths.
Right.
That is also a dangerous thing to do for the body and more prone to getting cancer.
And aging of the skin.
In addition, just as we summarize, the other things that we can do, we wear clothing to protect our skin, wear hats,
right.
sunglasses, protect our eyes.
Yes, I don't mean to interrupt, but you mentioned sunglasses. Yes, also sunlight causes cataracts and glaucoma.
Exactly.
So particularly cataracts more so.
Yes.
So definitely need to wear sunglasses so to protect two things. Cataracts,
exactly.
And also so you don't get sun damage around the eyelids and skin cancer around the eyelids.
That starts even
Good
with
point.
Little ones, too.
Yes.
Little ones should have hats on,
yes.
besides that sunscreen, but also sunglasses to protect their developing eyes, right?
Exactly.
Okay, so now we've covered that related to that and cancers, but there are other things that we kind of quickly cover in summarization of things that people can do to take care of their skin,
right.
i.e., people want to know what type of things should they use on the skin to clean the skin. To moisturize
right.
the skin, what should they be looking for?
Basically, we recommend hypoallergenic products.
Okay.
And products will say that they're hypoallergenic on it.
Okay.
Dermatology tested, hypoallergenic, that's
All
what
right.
you want to look for.
All right.
In dermatology, we're particularly worried about contact allergies as well. So we prefer products that are fragrance-free.
All right.
Now, obviously, if someone uses a product that they look like the smell of and they don't have a problem with that, that's fine.
Okay.
But we only recommend products that are fragrance-free.
Fragrance-free,
hypoallergenic.
Okay.
You want it to not have a lot of chemicals in it.
Right.
So we prefer just things that are very simple. Vaseline is a great moisturizer, particularly for infants. Vaseline or Aquaphor is a great moisturizer for infants, even
okay.
for adults as well.
Okay.
Obviously, as we get older, we don't like greasy things on our skin, so we prefer more lotions and creams.
Yes.
So products like Cetaphil
okay.
is an excellent moisturizer.
All right.
CeraVe is an excellent All right. moisturizer.
All right.
Neutrogena makes an excellent line of moisturizers.
Very good.
So what I tell people is whatever feels good on their skin,
mm-hmm.
As long as it's hypoallergenic, that's what they should use. And they should use it year-round. Particularly in the wintertime, it's important to moisturize.
Okay.
Because dry skin itches.
Yes.
we call winter itch.
Yes.
We call it xerosis or acetotic eczema.
Yes.
But winter itch is basically just itching from dry skin.
All right.
So it's important to moisturize in the winter and use a good mild soap as well.
Okay. So cleanser, moisturize, and cream. For dryness and everything else, and from
right.
an aging perspective, all those same things?
All of those things, plus don't smoke. Smoking
don't smoke.
Ages the skin.
Yeah.
Not just inhaling the smoke, but just the smoke on the skin, the chemicals in the toxins in the smoke age the skin.
Okay.
And diet plays a big role as well.
As far as a healthy
non-inflammatory diet.
Which means?
Inflammation is bad for your body in general and bad for your skin. It ages the skin.
What inflammation?
Fried foods.
Okay.
foods that are high in fat content.
Okay.
You want to eat more fish, like salmon, okay, haddock. Almonds are very good for the skin.
Okay.
Particularly, but they should be preferably the unflavored, unsalted,
unbleached,
natural, raw, right.
Right.
That's the best thing. Blueberries are antioxidant, anti-inflammatory.
What else for the skin?
In terms of diet, mm-hmm, well, fruits in general are good, particularly blueberries, as I mentioned. And avoid sugar, because that's also pro-inflammatory. You want to avoid things that are inflammatory. They're bad for your body and they're bad for your skin.
So eat healthy, life-giving food.
Right.
Make sure you cleanse your skin with good products, that you moisturize, that you follow it up with a cream so it doesn't dry out, as well as have sunscreen and wear protective clothing.
Right, and you can't overdose on moisturizers.
Okay.
I use hand cream probably 40 times a day because I wash my hands a lot because I'm with patients all the time.
Very good.
We don't recommend people wash their hands 40 times a day unless you're seeing patients.
Okay.
But try to limit hand washing because it dries out the skin a lot. But anytime they do wash their hands, particularly in the winter, they should put a good moisturizer on.
Can you ever overdose on sunscreen?
How
often do you apply it?
Usually every 90 minutes.
Every 90 minutes.
But
and if you're in the water?
The same thing. It should be applied every 90 minutes.
Very good.
But we don't want people out there too long anyway. So really, after 90 minutes or 2 hours or so, that's kind of, unless they're on a professional baseball team or something, they should kind of head back indoors.
Yeah. Okay. This has been very informative, Dr. Posnick. We thank you very much. And for our audience, please make sure that you go to the end of the program and you see the websites that you can go to download your prevention of skin cancer and how to examine yourself and what you can do to protect yourself. It's been a pleasure being with you. Until next time, have a wonderful day.
You can catch skin cancer early by examining your skin. Involving a partner is especially helpful when checking the back and other hard-to-see areas. Here's how to check your skin and what to look for. When examining your skin, look for the ABCDEs of melanoma. Make an appointment with your dermatologist immediately if any of your moles have these signs. A. Asymmetry. One half of the spot is unlike the other half. B. Border. The spot has an irregular, scalloped, or poorly defined border. C. Color. The spot has varying colors from one area to the next, such as shades of tan, brown, or black, or with areas of white, red, or blue. D. Diameter. Melanomas are usually greater than 6 millimeters, or about the size of a pencil eraser when they're diagnosed, but they can be smaller. E. Evolving. A mole or spot on your skin that looks different from the rest or is changing in size, shape, or color. You can use the American Academy of Dermatology's free body mole map to help you keep a record of your moles. A record helps you detect spots that are growing, bleeding, itching, or changing in any way. Make sure to add any new moles or sores that heal but keep returning. You start a self-skin exam by looking at the front and back of your body. When examining your own skin, stand in front of a mirror, raise the arms, and examine the right and left sides of the body. Then, bend your elbows and look carefully at your forearms, upper underarms, and palms. Next, examine the back of your legs, spaces between your toes, and your soles. Then, examine those hard-to-see areas like your back, buttocks, and the top of your head. Use a mirror to inspect the back of your neck and scalp, parting your hair for a better view.
Become familiar with your skin, especially your moles, and alert your dermatologist about any changes to moles or spots in your skin. Catching skin cancer early is key for successful treatment.
To find a dermatologist in your area, visit aad.org.